Setting up your asset library will take you only a few minutes, but will save you hours of work down the line. You'll be creating a bunch of cool stuff watching my videos, other creators, and in your own projects, and you'll want to reuse those assets again and again. The asset library lets you just drag and drop it to your scene. A quick shout out to our community, we've already reached our first 170 subscribers in a couple of months. Thank you all so much for that, and for all of your comments. I really enjoy the interaction. So here's to all of us, and for those of you who had a bit of trouble setting up the walls orientation the first video, I'll address that later in this one, so be sure to check that out. Now let's jump right in. Alright, I recommend you to have an asset browser window by default, as it's something that you'll be using a lot once you start building your library. I also recommend you to have a size reference instead of the default cube. I use this low poly human that you can download for free in my Gumroad. The link is in the description. Once you've set up your workplace, go to File, Defaults, and Save Startup File. That way, Blender will look exactly how you left it the next time you open it. Go to Edit, Preferences, and File Paths. If you scroll all the way down, you'll find Asset Libraries. I would suggest you have at the very least a Materials and a Models library, but you can have as many or as few as you want. You can add or remove libraries with these plus and minus buttons. Everything you create here will show up in this drop-down menu on the Asset Browser. When you add a new one, you'll need to specify a folder in your computer. Make sure that it's a path that you can easily find. Now every Blender file that you save in that folder will be reviewed for assets, and they will show up in your library. Import method sets the default management of the models in your scene. Append reused data creates a local copy in your scene. And if you import the same model several times, it will not create additional geometry. So for example, if I import a table to my scene, you'll see that it adds one object and some geometry. But if I add the same table again, you'll see that it adds another object, but it did not add any more geometry. This will keep your files more efficient, lighter, and faster. Also, note that if you do it in this way, if you edit one of the models, the change will apply to all of the instances of that model. Also, it's important to mention that for this to work properly, the assets in your library should not have any modifiers. If I add, for example, this gaming chair that has a couple of modifiers, and then I add it again, you'll see that it changes the amount of geometry in the file. So keep that in mind when you're creating assets for your library. Append always adds new geometry, and each instance is independent of each other. So if you want to make slight changes to make each object different, you can use this. Link will keep all of the object's properties from the original file. So if I add this bed, it drops it on the location where it is on the original file, and I cannot scale it, move it, or modify it in any way. I don't know what the application would be for this, but I never use it. I recommend you to leave it in the append reuse data, and if you ever want to quickly change it for a specific project or one specific model, you can change it directly in the asset browser in this drop-down menu. I'm gonna go to my models library folder. You'll see that there are only two Blender files. It's easier to manage if you have several models on the same file instead of one model per file. And all of these folders are to store the texture data of the models. Now, if I open this file, you'll see that I have several models here, loosely organized by room. So all of my plants are here, the bathroom, living room, and so on and so forth. If you have very complex models, you might want to have less objects per file so that they don't slow down your computer. I'll create a very simple chair to show you the workflow. You don't actually need to create your asset directly in the file. You can just create it in a separate file and then copy it when you're done. So let's say that's our chair. There are a few things you need to check for your asset to work properly. I always make sure that the origin isn't the base of the model. When you drag and drop the model, I've encountered occasions when Blender takes the origin as the anchor point when you place it. Also, if you ever want to slightly change the size, you will not need to adjust the Z location. So if I have a floor plane and place a table on it, it will do it correctly. And if I place a banana on the table, it also works. I can also resize the banana and it stays in the correct location. We can shift left click on the base of the chair and then select the chair in object mode, right click, set origin to 3D cursor. And now just place a chair in a suitable place in your file. The second thing is size. Make sure that your object has the correct proportions. I usually place my size reference next to the object and eyeball the scale. But you can also check the exact dimensions in the item tab here. Press N or on this arrow if you don't see it. And make sure that you're in the item tab. Once you're happy with the size, select it, then press Ctrl A and apply the rotation and scale transforms. The third thing is, if your model consists of several meshes, join them into one. Let's say I had a pillow on the couch. Select all of the meshes in object mode and press Ctrl J. Make sure that the origin is still in the base, and if not, do the same thing that we did before. Now we need to rename the mesh. If by mistake you created the mesh inside a collection, which actually happened in this case, just expand the collection and drag the mesh out. I like to use this notation with no spaces and capitalize the first letter of each word to keep the names short. Save the file in the path that you specified in the preferences. You can name it something like furniture, for example, or just models like I did here. Now we need to mark it as an asset. On the outliner, right-click on the name and mark as asset. You'll get this symbol next to the name. Now you will see this object in the library. If you don't, make sure that you're on the right library and click on refresh. The asset should be in the unassigned category. You can create new categories, although Blender calls them catalogs, with this plus sign. Create one and call it chairs. Go back to the unassigned catalog and drag the object into the newly created catalog. You'll see an asterisk next to the name of the catalog. This means that it has not been saved. Click on this icon to save it. Now this chair can be used in any model that you work on just by dragging and dropping it. You can change the size of the thumbnails in the View Display Size menu. Now you can do the same thing with materials. For me, it's easier and more organized to have a separate file, but you could do everything on the same file if you wanted to. This is the way I have set up my materials file. I like this shape because I can see how the material will look both on flat and curved surfaces. Let's quickly create a simple material to show you the process. I recommend specifying in the name of the material if it's procedural or textured and its resolution. This is a procedural material, so I'll name it PR Plastic. If I had used a texture, I would have called it something like 2K Plastic so that I would know that it's made with a 2K resolution image, as this will impact my render times. Save this file in your asset libraries path if you haven't done so. Now in the materials panel, you can right click on it and mark as asset. You'll see the asset symbol here. You could also go to the outliner and select the Blender file display mode. From here, you can see all of the materials in your scene and which of them are already marked as assets. Now create a new catalog in your asset browser and drag the material. Don't forget to save both the catalogs and the file. Now you can drag and drop this material to any mesh. When working on new files, your asset browser will be on the current file by default. If you want to access your library, select it from this drop-down menu and you're good to go. Now you just need to build your asset collection. With this tool, you can easily furnish a floor plan and try different floors and walls in seconds. That was it for the library. Now we'll jump into the troubleshooting for the walls on the first video of the series. Stick around, because even if you aced it the first time, I guarantee that you'll apply these tips in other projects. I got a few comments from viewers that couldn't get the walls right in the first video, so let me go into more detail. I'll use this very complex structure to show you the process. We need to turn on the face orientation overlay. The first step is to make sure that all of the outer walls are blue. If you find any red walls, make sure that you're in the face selection mode, select them and press Shift N. If they do not change orientation, then check this box. Do the same with all of the outer walls until all of them are blue. Now if I add a solidify modifier and go to top view, I can see that a few of the walls do not look good. The face orientation determines the direction to which the solidify modifier will create the volume. Turn it off so we can see where the problems are. The volume will be created towards the red direction if the solidifier has the offset in -1. This is important because you have to consider the volume of the bricks and the walls in your plan, and you have to respect the boundaries of the land lot. That's why we leave the outer walls in the blue color, so that the volume of the wall will go into the house. On the inside, you have to make sure that continuous walls that are made up of several segments like this one has all of its segments facing the same direction, while making sure that you do not change the orientation of the outer walls. This wall that is continuous has this segment facing the wrong direction, so Shift N, inside, and now this wall has all of its segments facing the right direction. If we just look around, we can see that this wall has the same problem and this wall has the same problem, so let's fix that. Now all of the continuous walls are made up of segments that are facing the same direction. Now if we turn the solidify modifier back on and go to the top view, we can see that everything is working a-okay. However, there are two more things that could be causing trouble. The first one is if you accidentally doubled a vertex. For example, if you selected one vertex, extruded it, then right-clicked, then you might have extruded it again at some other point and press right-click, the vertices are still there, which may cause trouble with your model. To fix this, this, make sure that you're on vertex select mode. Press A to select all of the vertices, M to merge by distance, and you'll see that it removes some of the vertices if you had any doubled vertices in your model. The second one is if for some reason you doubled a wall. For example, we have these two wall segments. If you select these two vertices and these two vertices, skipping the ones in the middle, and then press F to make a face, it will mess up the wall. If you have the solidify modifier turned on, you might see artifacts like this, and the wall might be thicker, and it also might look wrong, like in this case. But if you turn the solidify modifier off and you rotate around, it's very easy to see, as you will see a funny effect on the wall. This is called Z-fighting, and it happens when two planes overlap each other, and Blender cannot decide which one to show you. To fix this, you just need to select the wrong plane and delete it. An easy way to select the plane is to go to wireframe mode and make sure that you're in the face select mode. You can see the centers of each face. Now, click on the center of the wrong wall, it will highlight the whole wall, so you know that you selected the one that we needed to. Now press X and make sure you delete only faces, because we want to keep the other vertices intact. Now if we go back to solid view and turn the solidify modifier back on, we can see that the whole model is working perfectly. At this point, we can just turn the face orientation overlay off. That's it for today. Drop a like, comment, and subscribe if you liked the video. I'm Dude Blender. Happy blending.